l'épicier l'avait gardée dans son comptoir. Le percepteur la conservait dans son tiroir. La fleur si belle de notre espoir. Le pharmacien la dorlotait dans un bocal. L'ex-caporal en parlait à l'ex-général. Car c'était elle, notre idéal. C'est une fleur de Paris, du vieux Paris qui sourit. Car c'est la fleur du retour des beaux jours. Pendant quatre ans, dans nos cœurs, elle a gardé ses couleurs. Bleu, blanc, rouge, avec l'espoir, elle a fleuri. Fleur de Paris. Fleur de chez nous, elle a fleuri de partout, car c'est la fleur du retour des beaux jours. Pendant quatre ans, dans nos cœurs, elle a gardé ses couleurs, bleu, blanc, rouge, elle était vraiment avant tout fleur de chez nous.
The history of these steamships is just so important. It's a big segment of what makes America America. So, kind of give us a rundown of you know, kind of what the place looks like.
Sure, no kidding. I mean, the organization, when it started way back in '35, as your intro indicated, it was really seven gentlemen, and they were just aficionados, the amateur historians, interested in technology and how things worked, because everything was mechanical then. And they collected photographs and ephemera, you know, paper products, posters, and all sorts of data. And they traded these things among themselves, like baseball cards. And that led to a newsletter being published that was called Steamboat Bill. It first came out in 1939, and we're now in issue number 314, and it's called Power Ships Magazine now.
Yes,
so it went
yes.
from like a manually typed and glued black and white photos onto it to today's 88-page print journal, also available electronically. And people can sign up through our website.
Steamship Historical Society of America's 2002 Ship of the Year is the SS Badger. The SS Badger was built in 1952 and is around 410 feet long. She is the last coal-fired passenger ship operating in the U.S. The SS Badger was originally built to carry train freight, however, over time she began to transport passengers and vehicles. Today, the SS Badger is a staple of the Great Lakes, offering private staterooms and activities while still operating as a ferry across Lake Michigan between Manitowoc and Ludington.
You know, sometimes we plug in some fun stuff on the calendar, and I don't care what the news cycle does to us. We're going to talk about our fun stuff, and this is one of them. Check out this headline. Steamship Museum with large collection opens in Rhode Island, and we have its executive director and publisher. Mr. Schulte is here. Matthew, nice to have you.
Thank you, Dan. Happy to be here. We're on Post Road on the old NEIT campus at 2500 Post Road, so right on the corridor of I-95 and Amtrak and TF Green. It's about 8,000 square feet, and it's two levels. And we have archival space. We have probably the best ephemera or brochure collection for ocean liners and steamships in the country. And all these things, the question is, well, what are you going to do with this? Mm-hmm. And the answer to that is hopefully energize tomorrow's generation to looking and asking questions like, how did we get here? Where did this come from? And how do things work? In the old days of steam engines, you could look at it mechanically and physically understand what was happening. Okay, we're boiling something and it's creating steam and it's turning something mechanically. In today's world with, you know, I have iPhones and iPads and all that and kids that teach me how to use them.
But, I know the feeling.
Yeah, but we hope to really energize folks so that they can see where they came from and the importance of maritime in today's world.
But show me what's in the museum. We've got some, can we have some show and tell here, Stephen? Just throw me some pictures. What's this thing?
Well, we got the bells and whistles. So that's an example of one of the whistles that sailed along on the Hudson River steamer, either the Alexander Hamilton or the Robert Fulton or one of these. I mean, people used to travel on the water, not just for fun, but to go from place A to B. So you could sail from New York City up to Albany, and they had regular steamers plying the river. And this is a great part of a collection that we have, the Hudson River Dayline collection, right here in Rhode Island. There's a bell. Hey, the bells and whistles. We have a few of those, but we have it down low so kids can go and ring that thing. And it's really loud because, you know, museums need some sounds as well.
All right.
Glass plates. Positives, negatives, prints. These are some examples about 100 years old that predated sort of slideshows. They were magic lantern shows. So the Vaterland there on the bottom was a ship that became the U.S. line's Leviathan. We took it from Germany, First World War. So there's just great stories to see and learn about. We've got steamer trunks around instead of ropes hiding things or keeping people out. We encourage people to open up and look around and touch things. The space is also adaptable. So that has gallery space there now, but we can have functions there, receptions, and we can have school kids bop around and move into other places.
It's cool.
And areas.
When people come, they're hands-on?
They are, yeah. I mean, we have some things behind glass, but the idea is that they're not going to be there a real long time, so we want them to get in and absorb what's happening and to ask questions. They may want to know what it was like to come across as their great-grandparents did, you know, 100 years ago in third class, or we can help them find a photograph of the very ship. Very romantic. It was in an era where you could get on a boat here in Providence at 5 o'clock and have some wine, have a nice dinner, relax, listen to music, go into your cabin and wake up the next morning in New York City.
I'm guessing you give a presentation or two when you're at the museum, yes?
We do, and we're happy to have people come.
Are there formal presentations at the museum?
There are. We're going to start a speaker series after the first of the year, and probably on Saturdays. And based on feedback, we'll change that. We'll have evenings as well, and we're excited to have people come and volunteer and experience it with us.
So it's no charge to come to the museum, but donations are accepted,
that's
correct?
That's right. All right. That's absolutely
or
true.
Or join the nonprofit for $50 you're in, right?
That's right.
Congratulations.
Thanks,
on
Dan.
The whole project.
Thank
Looking
you.
Looking forward to seeing it.
All right.
Last word when we come back.
The SS Belle of Louisville was launched in 1914 as the Idlewild. She is 168 feet long, with a 36-foot beam and a 5-foot draft. The Idlewild initially operated as a passenger ferry between Memphis, Tennessee and West Memphis, Arkansas. In 1931, she was chartered by the Rose Island Company in Louisville to run between Fontaine Ferry Amusement Park and Rose Island. In 1947, she was sold and her name was changed to the Avalon. For the next 13 years, she was the most widely traveled river steamer in the U.S. In 1962, Judge Marlowe Cook bought the Avalon, renaming her Belle of Louisville. He had her restored, fixing the hull, decks, and superstructure. In 1963, she made her first cruise as the Belle of Louisville in a race with the Delta Queen. The Belle of Louisville is recognized as the oldest river steamboat in operation in the U.S. and is a National Historic Landmark. Today, she continues to run regular cruises out of Louisville with a dedicated crew working to preserve her.
Hi, Michelle here from the Development Office of Steamship Historical Society of America. I'm here today to talk to you about the Fellowship League. Fellowship League, also known as your Legacy Society or Planned Giving Society for all nonprofits, is Steamship Historical Society's special Legacy League. In the 85-year history of SSHSA, we've benefited from almost $3 million of thoughtful, quiet gifts. I say quiet because for the most part, we don't even know that the donor had this thoughtful intention until they have passed. If you have a story where you have made a great intention in your will or your retirement plan or your life insurance policy, let us know. Call us. We want to steward and thank you for your gift today. If you would like to be a member of the Fellowship League, and would need some advice on what the best product or way to do that is, also call us, talk to me. I'm happy to do so and walk you through it and point you in the direction of the experts. In the meantime, I want to thank you for your time today and listening to my story, and I look forward to talking to you soon about the Fellowship League for SSHSA.
Stare lassù nel blu dipinto di blu felice di stare lassù
penso che un sogno così non ritorni mai più mi dipingevo le mani e le facce di blu poi d'improvviso venivo dal vento rapido Cominciavo a volare nel cielo infinito, volare, oh, oh. Cantare, oh, 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 oh. Nel blu dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù.
E volavo, volavo felice, poi in alto del sole ed ancora più su. Mentre il mondo pian piano spariva lontano laggiù.
Una musica dolce suonava soltanto per me. Di blu
Steamship Society of America is offering some free activities that are online right now. So it's all because of the COVID-19 crisis, of course, but hopping online, I think we're a little used to that now these days. Things like boat buildings with Legos, making origami ships, also learning the physics of sailing. You can all do that from the comforts of your home. Artie Teft caught up with them.
We welcome in Astrid Drew and Amy Bakari of the Steamship Historical Society of America. Believe it or not, people, that is in Warwick, Rhode Island. So, Amy, tell us where people can find you, because I think a lot of people don't even know you guys are around.
Yeah, so we're located right on Post Road, right next to the airport, 2500 Post Road. We have hours by appointment only, and obviously right now during the pandemic, we're sort of not allowing anyone in at the moment, but the beautiful thing right now is that we're doing a lot of things online.
Astrid, one of the big things that you guys are touting right now is that you have lessons available for teachers and students.
It's at shiphistory.org. It's our educational program online. And the majority of the materials are archival materials taken from our own collections, our library, and image collections. There are some other materials from like the Library of Congress and other open access materials as well. But it's all historical documents, and they are incorporated into lessons and activities that is open for everybody to use.
Lessons.
So our goal was to create a STEAM curriculum, so science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. But, you know, we are a historical society, so many of the lessons are interdisciplinary. So we wanted to have a website where people are directly from the documents, but for STEAM subjects, and really for all ages. We're adding more and more as time goes on.
And Astrid, it looks like there's a kind of cool virtual gallery that shows some artwork from old steamships and some other STEAM-related stuff. Talk about that.
Our virtual maritime museum. The main exhibit there is the Posner Maritime Collection. It includes a lot of wonderful fine art, lots of original paintings, as well as models and half hull models. And those are all digitized in our image portal as well.
When things start picking up and people are allowed to visit again, what are people expected to see when they go to the site in Warwick?
We rotate them out from time to time, but we have an archive so people can come in and look at photographs, postcards, deck plans, lots of different things.
Also, the library is wonderful to explore, and people are free to come and browse and definitely ask questions and talk to me about it, about what they see.
All right, well, hopefully this will help people know that you guys are right around the corner in Warwick, right on Post Road. Good talking to you guys.
Okay.
You can find the lessons and more information at sshsa.org or shiphistory.org.
Website and I would urge our listeners to visit shiphistory.org and you'll get into there. But one of the things I notice that you do a lot of, and that's education, K through 12 students that really get a real good solid background of what this was all about in those days, and also looking at some new things in technology and engineering and things. So expound a little bit on some of the educational programs that are offered there.
Yeah, right on. I mean, when we started here, it was a mouthful to say SSHSA or Steamship Historical Society of America. That's hard to explain to people. So we started branding the ship history because that's our talking point now. So when people ask us what we do, we say we're in the ship history business. They get it, and that leads the conversation. But a funny thing happened in the last few years with this term STEAM. It's our first name, and it's always been our name, and we're proud of it. But with science, technology, engineering, arts, and math, now these are it's a buzzword, and it's in every curriculum from the STEM to the STEAM. We add the A for arts. And so we realized about 4 years ago that the heyday of the technology and the use of STEAM was in the past, although modern military vessels that are nuclear-powered all still use STEAM, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah.
But for today to be relevant to kids, they are very interested in this information, but we were delivering it in the wrong format. They don't want to read a print magazine. They want this information to absorb, but on tablets, on their phones, via computer, and they want it now and free. So,
yes.
So we developed through our collections a digitization process and a curriculum that works throughout the country, relevant to stories of the immigration, trade, and leisure through STEAM, so science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. And there's a curriculum developed on that shiphistory.org that has now taken off during the pandemic because we had ready to go this dynamic website that people could spend a couple hours on, or you could spend several days doing these projects and people learn, and it's been a real salvation. So we're feverishly fundraising and writing for more grants to make it even more robust so that school districts and classrooms across the country and worldwide can tap into that and use it. Everybody here in America, just about everybody, came from somewhere else, and most of the time that was through the water. So our three themes are immigration, trade, and leisure, and that propels us here in this 21st century because those three themes, everything we do, ties into those to make us relevant, not just to the past, but looking forward to the next generation.
Steamship Historical Society of America's 2004 Ship of the Year is the SS Milwaukee Clipper. The SS Milwaukee Clipper was originally named the Juniata and was launched in 1904. She was 316 feet long and ran on four coal-powered steam engines. She carried freight between New York and Minnesota for the Pennsylvania Railroad Company until 1937, when she was decommissioned. In 1940, she was sold to be rebuilt and work as a passenger ferry on Lake Michigan. The SS Milwaukee Clipper's wooden superstructure was completely rebuilt with steel, and she was converted to run on oil, but still retained the four steam engines. She was capable of carrying about 900 passengers and 120 vehicles. She had been fitted with air-conditioned staterooms, a movie theater, a dance floor, playroom, and a sports deck. She continued to operate on her route across Lake Michigan until 1971, and in 1977, started operating as a museum ship out of Navy Pier in Chicago, Illinois. Between 1977 and 1997, the SS Milwaukee Clipper was moved around until she made her way to Muskegon, Michigan, where the SS Milwaukee Clipper Preservation Organization is working to restore her. She is a national landmark and is a major part of the Great Lakes maritime history, offering an authentic look back on the 20th century.
breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in the sycamore tree, dream a little dream of me. Say nighty-night and kiss me. Just hold me tight and tell me you'll miss me. While I'm alone and blue as can be, dream a little dream of me. Stars fading, but I linger on, dear, still fading your kiss. I'm longing to linger till dawn, dear, just saying this. Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you, sweet dreams that leave all worries behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of me.
More questions for you. We're talking with Matt Schulte, the executive director of the Steamboat Historical Society of America. Tell me what you know now. A particular ship that I did some research on and some interviews on. It's been a couple of years, I guess, maybe even a little more. The United States. Do you have any updates on what's going on with this vessel?
Yes, indeed. The United States is still in Philadelphia, where she's been for a few decades, languishing. But for those that aren't familiar, she is the flagship of our country. She was created in the early 50s and immediately set the world's record for speed across the Atlantic. It's a record that's held to this day. No ship is faster. She came out of service in 1969. She could easily transport and be converted to take troops.
Uh-huh.
However, it was right at the jet age. So right as she came online, the military said, you know what, it's smarter and faster to take people on airplanes, on jets. So she kind of, as soon as she peaked, she was obsolete.
Mm.
So she was then mothballed for 20-some years and then went over and got asbestos overseas removed from her, and everybody thought it was the end. And then she made the tow back, and there's a group online called the SS United States Conservancy, and they purchased the ship. They're a nonprofit, and they're working very hard to find a new home for her. They're working with a real estate developer in New York. It makes all the sense in the world to have her as an attraction, a hotel, a convention center, a multi-purpose experience in New York City at her home port. However, you know, it's just a dollars thing. So mm-hmm. Can they do it? We shall see. They're working as hard as they can, and people can find them online too. And it's a great story, and it's sad that it's gotten to the point where we have to fight to save national treasures like this, but some of it's just an awareness. We see it. It's a very beautiful ship, and there's so much potential there. It's just, I don't know, why can't our government just print some more money for that and save the United States?
Yeah, really. Well, I can listen to them all day long. They're great. Celtic Thunder, thank you so much. Let's get back to our interview with Matt Schulte. And Matt, you know, there's a lot of things that people want to know, but one of the things I want to make sure you get out to our listeners is how can they get involved by donating or becoming a member of the society?
Yeah, no, thanks for asking. Through our website, through shiphistory.org and the sshsa.org porthole, people can make contributions. They can join. They can see what we have to offer from a $50 year membership or $35 as a student on up. They can also contribute their time, their reminiscences, their oral histories. We're really moving into this virtual world. People have adopted the Zoom meetings. We're doing more webinars and doing more interaction online. We see that increasing dramatically. And then come November, we have our gala, which is our fifth annual ocean liner gala, and it had been scheduled to be in May. We postponed it, and now we're looking at making most of it a virtual experience. What that means at this point, we're not really sure. But people will be able to join in and participate via their own home computers, and this is just the way the world has gone now. And you know, ultimately we need that physical presence and contact and proximity again, but for the time being we're going to try this.
Welcome to the Ship History Center and Steamship Historical Society of America's Ocean Liner Gala 5. My name is Don Levitt, and I'm president of the society. What a monumental year this has been for us. Not only that in a few days we'll be celebrating our 85th birthday, but in August we purchased our headquarters building. This is a huge deal. Now, tonight we'll be telling you why, while sharing our exciting plans and introducing you to some of the folks who have helped us get where we are today. We're also practicing social distancing. The tech guys are way over there in the back of the room, and my fellow co-hosts and I will be separated by 6 feet, represented by this table with this lovely pre-maiden voyage model of the SS United States. So without further ado, I am proud to introduce my good friend and our executive director, Matthew Schulte. Matt?
Thank you, Don. Today, as we celebrate our 85th anniversary, SSHSA collections include hundreds of thousands of images, artifacts, ephemera, memorabilia, and artwork, as well as a 20,000 plus volume reference library. For nearly 8 decades, the collection was stored in many locations throughout the country. But in 2015, we consolidated everything into one location and established the Ship History Center here in Warwick, Rhode Island. The Ship History Center serves as a museum, library, research center, meeting space, and office. It's an adaptable space, and today it's being used as a TV studio. Now to lead us forward, I'm pleased to introduce our MC for the evening, Kathy McPherson. Kathy?
Thanks, Matt. I am so excited to be here, as it is impossible to think of an America without maritime collections. The impact of ports, shipping, and maritime commerce in our world still touches everyone today. The industry does not attract a lot of publicity, and few people are aware of just how important ships are to our way of life, even today. But our mission of documenting, preserving, and sharing with all keeps this history alive. Don't you agree, Don?
Absolutely, Kathy. You know, SSHSA translates the history using the themes of immigration, trade, and leisure. The next generation can gain a clear understanding of where their ancestors came from, how goods got here, and what it's like to travel at sea. As an organization, it has been quite a feat to survive for 85 years, and even more impressive to be positioned to thrive now that this building has been purchased. Having a safe and secure place to share our history is so important. Matt?
It sure is, Don. And because of this, we developed the following goals: to catalog and share our collections, to increase accessibility via the internet, to integrate our STEAM education into classrooms everywhere, to deepen and expand the history and understanding of the importance of sea transportation, to communicate our mission using the three maritime themes of immigration, trade, and leisure. Kathy?
To achieve these goals, we must expand our presence beyond physical borders and cast a wide net by advancing our mission through virtual technology. This unlimited access encourages and fosters the interchange of ideas, images and writing, and the advanced knowledge and interpret the role ships play in our world. Our programs, the collections steaming into the future, and power ships act as the foundation of our mission. It was the mission of longtime member Fred Murray, who in 2018, at the age of 92, was able to make his way to Rhode Island and visit the Ship History Center. Here he is sharing his memories and his love for San Francisco ferry boats.
And I was at Marina Junior High School. This would have been fall 1939, I guess. And we were at our summer home in Ross. And my mother said, well, your father will be able to get you over by the bridge. I said, oh, I want to go on the ferry. I remember that, but I didn't get to go, but one time I did. And one day, I remember at junior high school, that my father, I looked out the window and saw the car, and I thought, I'm going to go to the streetcar and going to go down to the ferry building on that, and my father will not see me because I know how to leave to get on the car, down to the boat to make the 3:45, the Eureka heading to Sausalito, and the train to Ross. So my father never knew that I was, that's what I did. That's how much I was devoted to ferries, to miss that standard run over the bridge. I remember the last run. Oh, the people were drunk that night. It was a stormy night, February the 28th, 1941. And I'd been ill, I'd had flu, and I was weakened. And we had the doctor there, and he said, well, I don't know whether he's up to it to be able to do this tonight. But I said, this is my last chance. So I won out again with my family. And Father had me down there, and they had a sign which I saved, an old one hanging, no cars allowed on the last run of the boat. Then we came to having to leave, and we had a choice. Apparently there was a way to go by road around the land, and my mother wanted to go there, but I knew there was the ferry boat, and I screamed about that and won out. That sounds, I didn't always win with the ferries, but we did then, and we got on an old paddle wheeler, and we pulled out, and something happened. I don't know what it was, but it began to jerk and shape, and steam just poured out from under the paddle wheels, as I remember. Now, this is vague. We were at the stern of the boat in the car, and my mother got all worried. And we were going by a little island that had some tombstones. And I remember her saying, well, we'll all end up in the cemetery. I remember that, and sort of looking at me as if saying, you got us on this thing. But I'm particularly happy to be here because this enlivens a certain passion that I have, and I think that you've done beautifully with this marvelous, marvelous spot that I've read about, and I'm glad to be able to be here at 92 to share with it.
Matt, I've had the pleasure of meeting many of our longtime members, like Mr. Murray, and I've discovered they all share the passion for ships, which has been the cornerstone of our society from day one, back in 1935.
You're absolutely right, Don, and these kind of memories are just priceless. You know, he was so thrilled to make the pilgrimage here, and I was so honored to spend time with him. Unfortunately, a few months after his visit, he passed away, but he left these stories for us and for the next generations and some of his cherished possessions and a monetary gift to benefit our outreach efforts. This is what's really important because since 2016, we've been growing our online database of artifacts to share with the public beyond the physical walls of the Ship History Center. At present, less than 8% of our collections have been fully processed. Kathy?
That's right, Matt. In 2018, we launched another virtual resource using artifacts from the archives. Our education program, Steaming into the Future, is housed on a dedicated website, shiphistory.org, where lesson plans organized by grade, theme, and subject matter can be accessed. These collections are the tangible, visible storytellers of the past, and we hope to continue to preserve them all for decades to come. Here to tell us a bit more about what's needed to continue that work is SSHSA archivist Astrid Drew.
The breadth and history in SSHSA's collections is staggering. There are books and documents from the early days of steam engineering and the Industrial Revolution. There are photographs and paper ephemera that show off the art and culture of ship travel, as well as the more gritty aspects of the building and operation of these vessels. Artifacts and souvenirs tell still more stories about how people designed, built, worked, and lived in and around ships. There are so many things that I could highlight in the archives, and there are so many ways that one person can help. One collection in particular is the Thomas Franklin Collection of Photographs, which includes glass plate negatives documenting the harbor and waterfront of 19th and early 20th century New York. Glass plates can be incredible documentary items, often preserving crisp, detailed images. It needs some help, though. A relatively small donation of $200 can help purchase folding enclosures that will better protect a quarter of the delicate plates in this collection. In our library, there are books whose aged covers and bindings need extra protection. $200 would buy protective cases for almost all of the most at-risk volumes in our library. These are just some examples where a relatively small investment can have a lasting impact. With the Full Ahead campaign, we can establish better processes and funds to care for collections, but most critically, to get them out into the world through our online database and educational program at shiphistory.org.
Matt, as you know, my own connection with SSHSA came through the ephemera collection. Back when we were still in a warehouse, I began the monumental task of sorting and organizing our brochure files. Now, there were well-organized files from years earlier, and then there were hundreds of boxes and filing cabinet drawers filled with unsorted material. It took 4 years, but I'm happy to report that today, the Society has one of the foremost ship ephemera collections in the world.
I know, your dedication's amazing, and it's these sorts of stories and collections, Don, that tie all of our members together. Our supporters come from all walks of life, but the one thing everyone has in common, along with a love of the sea, of course, is that they collect something. Kathy.
The glass plate images and their incredible detail, the books, drawings, art, brochures, the Maritime Reference Library. It all supports the Steaming into the Future education curriculum, connecting the past with the future. Let's take a minute to hear more about the program.
Hi, my name is Amy Bachari, and I'm the Education Director for the Steamship Historical Society of America. Thank you so much for coming to our virtual gala. Here are some highlights from the past year and our goals for the future. During this unprecedented pandemic, other small organizations, museums, and nonprofits scrambled to focus their efforts on moving content online. Our forward-thinking team understood the value of virtual education long before the pandemic. We were using our Head Start to reach educators, parents, and students who need high-quality educational materials through targeted social media content, and we have been successful. Our user base has increased by 400%, thanks to the financial support of donors and the visionary leadership of SSHSA. While we already had content for middle, high school, and even college level students, we knew parents with younger kids needed access to hands-on STEAM activities for at-home learning. I had a team of two at home ready to be my test guinea pigs. They proved that adding early childhood education would enable us to reach more families. The foundation of our education program was built on being 100% free and accessible to all. The COVID-19 pandemic demonstrated that those who are less fortunate are at greater risk of losing educational access. Here's where you come in. We rely on donations to provide high-quality STEAM and primary source-based curriculum free of charge. With your donation today, we can continue making a difference and target low-income communities. It takes just $5,000 to create one new lesson and provide students who need it most with quality educational resources. So please open your wallets and consider making an impact in a child's life today.
As president, what has been so exciting for me to witness is the excitement and the enthusiasm that Steaming Into the Future has generated among school kids. Generations past and current have entrusted us with their collections. With our online education program, we now have the ability to share it with generations to come.
Right. And you know, Don, we learned so much from these kids. They're really interested in ship history and seeing how mechanical things work. However, we were packaging our product wrong to them. Powerships Magazine is our flagship print publication, but to reach kids today, we needed to reach them via their own technology with iPads, computers, and phones. We're doing this, but we really need your help.
That's right, Matt. The demand for Steaming Into the Future during and after the COVID-19 shutdowns motivates us to develop a program expansion. It will increase access to the archives and make them available in the online database through virtual museum exhibits. Our goal is to continue to meet the challenges created by COVID-19 and to increase access to high-quality virtual STEAM education lessons among K through 12 students. We will work directly with the school educators, public libraries, nonprofits, and also via social media boosts for smartphone access.
Your gifts tonight will help us fund the additional technology and staff needed to expand the reach of this important program. You will bring Steaming Into the Future directly to the educators for their K through 12 classrooms. Kathy, let's fund the future.
Let's do it. That's right, friends, this is when all the magic of giving happens. Now, if you're new to Fund the Future, the way it works is we start the evening at our highest level of giving, which tonight will be $5,000, and we move to our final level. Now, if there's a level of giving that's meaningful to you, or you feel inspired to give at a higher level than our starting amount, perhaps $25,000, $10,000, $1,000,000, please go ahead and click the Give button and type in that amount. So here we are at $5,000. Or if you'd like to give a nod to the SS United States, 4,960. This number is the number of minutes it took for the SS United States to break the speed record for transatlantic crossing. And she did it on her maiden voyage in 1952. 3.5 days, 4,960 minutes. So feel free to use that as a number for you. Now, your $5,000 gift tonight will provide the funds needed to develop a STEAM education module in its entirety. Now, this program was launched in 2018. It's free. Internet-based K through 12 educational enrichment resources. Is there someone out there that is giving a gift of to us of $5,000? Where's our first $5,000 donation, our $5,000 gift? Now remember, this experienced a 400% increase in usage due to the COVID pandemic, and we need your donations tonight. Tonight, you'll help support and bring the mission to the next generation. Is $5,000 out there this evening? I am looking for a gift right now of $5,000. Hold on, Matt?
Yes. Kathy, I'm really pleased to report to you that Tom has jumped in there with a bid of $5,000.
Fantastic. Tom, if you're watching from home, thank you. He called moments ago. Thank you so much, Tom. We so appreciate your gift at $5,000. Now, the Fund the Future will be open all evening. So again, if there's a level that's meaningful to you at any time, please give at that Give button now. Let's move to our next level of giving, $2,500. Now, your $2,500 gift tonight is about collection storage. Who would like to start us off in a gift of $2,500? When you do this tonight at 25, you are ensuring that collections like the Franklin Glass Plate Collection will be protected for decades to come. Your $2,500 can do that right now. Just click that $2,500 button. You can protect the Federal Shipbuilding Collection, or perhaps the paintings of Helena Smith Dayton. Your donations this evening at $2,500 will give us the opportunity to protect those collections and make them available for future generations to explore both in person and online. At $2,500 as a gift this evening. If you'd like to donate that dollar amount, please do so. Click that button at $2,500 and help us preserve those amazing collections at $2,500. Now we're gonna move to our $1,000 level this evening. And again, let's give a nod and tie right up to the SS United States. You can make a gift of $990 because that's her length overall. $1,000 is what we're looking for tonight, and we'd love to start that off. Is there a donor here right now that will gift $1,000? Now, there's a dedicated space at the Ship History Center for archival storage. Hey, we have Doug in at $1,000. Thank you so much for that gift, Doug. You are helping the Ship Center archival storage. You tonight just are helping. Is there anyone else out there at $1,000? The temperature controlled space we need, the shelving and the storage needed. We have another one, Steven, at $1,000. Thank you, Steven. These gifts are coming in. They're coming in. We appreciate that donation so very much. That gift tonight will continue to add to the value of our mission. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Douglas. Yeah, Don.
Phone call just came in. Doug has donated $1,000.
Doug, so, again.
Dan.
Dan.
All right, so we add another person.
We're adding another $1,000. Dan, are you watching at home, Dan? Because thank you so very much. We can't thank you enough for that gift. Let those gifts keep coming in. We're so excited about your generosity. You are changing this organization. You are continuing to move our mission forward. Now, let's move to the $500 level. Who'd like to start us off at $500 this evening? Now, with your gift, we have Christopher in at $500. Thank you, Christopher. Now, you're going to provide the storage supply items needed to protect these items in the collections. You're going to enable us to continue to accept rare and valuable artifacts. Thank you so much. We have someone else in. We have Charles in at $500. Thank you, Charles. We appreciate that gift so very much. You're going to help us procure the acid-free storage boxes and folders we need to preserve the historic documents and photos. With $500, you are doing that tonight. You are preserving history for decades to come. Decades to come. All ages will be here to admire and to peruse this history in this beautiful building, and the collections that we have are amazing. $500 is helping us get there. Thank you so much for those donations. Keep them coming in. And let's now move to our $250 level. $250, rare book preservation. How many rare books can we preserve tonight? Will you give us $250 to help with that? We have Ian at $250. Thank you, Ian. Let's hear it for Ian. We have John at $250. Thank you, John. $250, your gift is going to preserve the oldest. And we have Glenn at $250, Stephen at $250. Thank you so very much. That's four books right now. We have four books that are going to be perfectly preserved because of your efforts tonight. Your donation will take care of the books and the documents that really show us the beginning of steam engineering. That's how long ago these books were given. And here they are at our collection. $250 will help us preserve those very books. Now let's keep those donations coming in. Keep those gifts coming in. We are so appreciative of those gifts. And we'll move to our next level, $100. Now at a $100 level, we receive more than 200 research requests each year. Now you can make that happen tonight with your $100 gift. You can support one of those requests from start to finish. Glenn at $100. Thank you, Glenn. And Charles at $100. James at $100. Thank you so very much at $100. You are, oh, and Hunt is in at $100. Thank you so much, Hunt. We're so appreciative of that. Jim at $100. Jim at $200. Jim popped in there with $200. Thank you, Jim, so much for that donation. You know, $100 brings some of the more than 1 million photos, negatives, slides, and the 20,000 plus volume reference library to those researchers. Now, you'll do that tonight. You are start to finish helping those researchers get the information they need. So thank you very much. Keep those donations coming in. Keep those gifts coming in. And we're going to move now to our final level. This final Fund the Future level symbolizes the 85th anniversary year and its flagship program, Powerships. Ian is in at $85. Thank you, Ian. Now, who would like to jump in along with Ian and send a complimentary annual subscription? We have someone. Michelle is in at $85. Thank you. You're going to send a complimentary subscription to educators, schools, museums, and colleges across the nation. Now, let's keep those gifts coming in. If there's a Fund the Future level I did not mention, a dollar amount meaningful to you, feel free to click on that button and make your gift. If you have friends or family who couldn't join us tonight, please share the link with them. Remember, the silent auction, which has some spectacular items on there, all from the US lines, among other things, that's going to close at 11:59 p.m. on Sunday. And the Fund the Future, well, it stays open until 11:59 Sunday as well. Thank you so much. Keep those donations coming in. Keep those gifts coming in. Let's preserve this amazing history here. Matt?
Thank you so much, Kathy. This is so exciting for us here at the Ship History Center. If you could only imagine what it was like not having a home for so many years. And now we have this, and we have the future to look forward to here. Speaking of which, everything we've discussed thus far this evening is part of our comprehensive campaign for the next generation and to thrive for the next 85 years.
It is. And what's going to help us get there?
I think a live auction.
I think a live auction. Okay. Matt, I think we should do it right now.
Take it away, Kathy.
Right.
You're the best.
We have some live auction items tonight. Now remember, all you have to do is press the bid button to make your bid. What's our first item? The Kentucky Bourbon Trail. All right, you have a getaway for two, which includes 4 days, 3 nights accommodations at the 21C Museum Hotel in Louisville. Daily complimentary breakfast, a Louisville bourbon tour, admission to the Louisville Slugger Museum, a personalized, you guessed it, a Louisville Slugger bat, complimentary Wi-Fi, free concierge reservation service, plus a special Belle of Louisville experience. Let's get the bidding going. Let's get us started. There's a minimum 30-day advance reservation required. The amenities are abundant. There's a couple of blackout dates. It's really only April 30th to May 2nd, but otherwise the entire calendar is open to you and the travel is valid through December 31st, 2021. Let's open this up at $2,500. The bid increments are $100. $2,500 gets us started. This is the Kentucky Bourbon Trail. $2,500 will get you in there. This is going to be amazing. This trip is incredible. It's 4 days, 3 nights at the 21C Museum Hotel in Louisville. Who will open us up at $2,500 for this amazing trip? It's a bourbon tour. It's a Louisville Slugger tour. You get your own bat. It is an incredible opportunity. And then, of course, the special Belle of Louisville experience. It is an incredible package starting at $2,500. Let's see if we can get a bid in here at $2,500. $2,500 gets us started. The $100 increments will move from there. $2,500, we're going to go again for just another minute or so on this at $2,500. So get your bids in. See if you can get that bid in there at $2,500. Who wants to go to Louisville? Who wants to take that tour and stay at this amazing place? And then, of course, cap it with the Belle of Louisville experience at $2,500. Another 10, 15 seconds at $2,500, and let's go at $2,500. Where are we at 25? I know you're watching and you're thinking about it. Do you have to make a phone call to see if you're going to get the okay? Maybe, but maybe you should just hit that button right now on bid and let's go to Louisville. You'll love it, love it, love it. All right, are we going to pass on this? I'll give you another 10 seconds. Louisville, Louisville, Louisville. All right, we're going to move on to our next item, our second item. This is golf at Fisher's Island. Now, this golf is for four people. This course was rated number 10 in the United States by Golf Digest and features panoramic views from every green. This is an experience not to be missed. It was designed by Seth Rayner and opened in 1926, then improved in 2000 by the great Gil Hans. The 18-hole link-style golf course is one of the true untouched beauties of the East Coast. There's no expiration date here for this item. Mutually agreed upon date with John. He'll make that, organize that for you. It'll be fantastic. And again, this is something that you cannot get. This is an amazing opportunity to play golf at a place that is unlike any other. Our opening bid here for the foursome, at Fisher's Island, by the way, ranked number 10, Golf Digest, number 9. It's been ranked 9, 10, and 11 for the past, I don't know how many years. 750 gets us going. Who'll bid on the golf on Fisher's Island for your foursome? 750 gets us going, $750. This goes for thousands and thousands. This is an incredible item. What an opportunity to play. $750 gets us off the ground. So let's see where we are. Let's take a look at the board. And this is a $2,000 value at least. Is $750 out there? Do you want to take you and three others to Fisher's Island to play golf at this incredible location? $750 gets us started. Let's see where that is. I know there's somebody out there, you're calling your golf buddies to see if you want to get out here to Fisher's Island. I'd do it. I'd pick up the phone and make those calls. $750 gets us off the ground here with Fisher's Island Golf. You can come on in, call your friends, tell them it's a steal. It's a $2,000 value. I know there are a lot of golfers out there watching this tonight, and we want you to bid on this item. $750 gets it. $750 takes you to Fisher's Island for a round of golf that you will remember for the rest of your life. $750. Where are we? For $750, is there any bid right now? Let's get those bid buttons going. Hit that bid button. $750 gets us started. Let's see what we can do on this. We're going to give you another 30 seconds or so on this. $750. Again, let's move into that $750 bid. That'll get you that round of golf. You can do it. Let's bring that. And remember, all this money, by the way, is going towards all the things we talked about earlier. You are taking a trip to Fisher's Island for golf, but you are bringing money into the Ship History Center, and you are continuing to bring the history of ships through generations to come. That's what your $750 is doing for us tonight. $750, $750 gets us going. All right, are we gonna pass on this? Are we passing? Let's move. All right, I may grab that later on. Let's see. All right, number 3, Skipper America's Cup Yacht in San Francisco, the city by the bay, and the most hands-on sailing experience available. So first, let's talk San Francisco. Amazing, Twin Peaks, the highest point in the city, a 360-degree view of the city below, Golden Gate Park, Nob Hill, the crookedest street in the world, and destinations nearby, Wine Country, Big Sur, Lake Tahoe, and the food, fine dining at its best. Gary Danko, Michael Mina, both I've been to, amazing. The butler and the chef, the list is long. All right, let's talk sailing. The USA 76 will give you hands-on experience that is unparalleled. Take the helm of a high-speed yacht. Work the sail trim controls, the coffee grinders. Help them with the hoist or just relax on board as the yacht cuts through the waves of San Francisco Bay. Your trip for two includes 4 days, 3 nights accommodation at the Fairmont San Francisco, complimentary breakfast, and all room-related taxes, and you've got a hands-on two-and-a-half-hour day sailing experience aboard America's Cup class yacht USA 76. complimentary nightly wine down, W-I-N-E, reception, complimentary house car transportation within a couple mile radius, complimentary bikes, free concierge reservation service. This is an amazing package. We're going to open it at $2,500. Bid increments are $100. $2,500 gets you this amazing four-day, three-night San Francisco Bay sailing trip. $2,500 will get you started on that trip. It's an amazing 4 days, three nights at the Fairmont. 2.5 hours on this amazing racing yacht. That'll get us going. $2,500. $2,500 gets us off the ground with this item. Let's see if we can get someone in there to hit that button at $2,500. $2,500 it is. We'll get you sailing in San Francisco Bay. The wind down reception, the amazing opportunity for this. Let's see if we can get someone in there. Let's see, Matt's jumping in. Matt's going to jump in on this, I think.
Well, I just wanted to say, too, with all these packages, it's really tough during a pandemic.
It is.
You're doing a fabulous job. Keep it up. We'll keep this moving. Of course, we would throw in some other niceties like San Francisco National Maritime Historic Park,
nice.
Perhaps some research at the library there. But we're in the midst of a global pandemic. Do the best that you can here. Let's move along here. Maybe somebody will press it, or we'll leave it open a little
while.
We'll
leave it open. Okay. All right. Sounds like a great plan. All right, $2,500 gets us going. Matt, thank you for those add-ons. I love it, love it, love it. The library, who knows what else? Maybe another trip on San Francisco Bay. But let's move on to our Tuscany getaway now. Our next item is an amazing item. This is something you don't want to miss. And this is an incredible trip. Tuscany, beautiful Tuscany. Think of the movie Under the Tuscan Sun. It's a beautifully restored four-bedroom home located in the Tuscan hill town of Cortona. Casa San Marco occupies the top two floors of a former 16th century palazzo, overlooks stunning Church of the San Francesco, along with a beautiful valley below. It features four bedrooms. You can sleep eight with two kids. You can sleep 10 people there. It's incredible. It is has all the bells and whistles, the kitchen, dining, living room area, a den with a terrace and stunning views. The decor, the two top floors, is an amazing high ceiling, original arch windows. It's been completely remodeled. This is an incredible package. It has everything you need. It's located in Upper Cortona, overlooking the stunning valley. Let's think about this, because you are right near the Chianti region that is incredible. You're near the Church of San Francesco. It's an incredible 10-minute walk to the main piazza, Della Repubblica. So what does this package include? It's a one-week stay, Saturday to Saturday, at this beautiful location in Tuscany. You have assistance planning your stay in Tuscany. You have a complimentary concierge service. All right, this is a steal. Remember, sleeps eight. With two kids, that's 10. $2,900 gets us started with a bid increment of $100. $2,900 gets us going. Hit that button. $2,900 will get this Tuscany trip. This is really an incredible opportunity and an experience in this most amazing region of Italy. Chianti's right there. The wine, the food, incredible. Sleeps eight. And keep in mind, every dollar that you donate to us this evening and give as gifts this evening, help us continue this mission for another number of decades ahead. $2,900, let's go. $2,900 gets us started. Is there anyone out there to hit that button at $2,900? $2,900? Matt, you have somebody in here for $2,900? I hear some noise over here. Is
well,
there someone?
I just wanted to point out, you know, with the COVID out there, with countries being shut down.
That's true.
One of the great things about this package is they drop the level of its opening bid down $1,000 from
right.
the value. It's really worth twice as much as this, but it's good for the next 36 months.
That's
you
right.
Can't go in 21, can't go in 20, want
so
to go
look
in 2023.
At that.
Try it out.
3 years you have to go to Tuscany. 3 years. They've dropped this down. Great point, Matt. Incredible. $2,900. $2,900 to go to Tuscany Saturday to Saturday. Saturday to Saturday. You just have to get yourself there. Once you're there, once we're open, once the world is open, we'll get back to travel, and you'll want to go here for the wine, the food, and the amazing area of Tuscany. $2,900. Let's get that bid in here. $2,900 gets us started. $2,900. We'd love to see it. Hit that button at $2,900. Get that bid in here so you can go to Tuscany and know that you are supporting our mission. Let's give it another 30 seconds, 10 seconds. We'll see.
Yeah, 10 seconds.
10 seconds will go. All right, you got 10 seconds. We'll count it down to 987. All right, keep in mind that this trip is a once in a lifetime. All right, we're going to move on from this trip. You may see them a little bit later, but I want to say this. Thank you all for your amazing generosity and support tonight. Keep in mind, you have until 11:59 Sunday to bid on silent items and give to fund the future. Thank you again for your amazing giving tonight. Matt?
Well, thank you, Kathy, and thanks for your patience and great job moving it on. We'll keep these open in case anybody wants to look at them, peruse a little longer.
Yes.
And right now, I think we'll run one more story. People have been very patient tonight, and let's take a look at this tape. It's typical of so many of our members.
I'm my name is Fred Eichmann. I grew up in the northwest side of Chicago. Well, I've always had an interest in boating the sea, and starting from when I was 7 years old, when my father took me racing with him on his sailboat, and that started a lifelong involvement with sailing, which continues to this day. And when I was young in model building, I had built small sailboat models and plastic models of Navy ships. And this model here, the American Scout, was captured my interest when I was probably 12 years old, and as a confirmation present, my grandmother Sophie Steinbach bought it for me, and when I was 13 and 14 years old, built it when we lived on the northwest side of Chicago. I built it entirely myself, other than my dad helped build the case because that required a power saw to cut it, once I got this far along, the detailing I did of putting canvas covers on the cargo hatches, and I've got a pile of lumber on the hatches forward and after the superstructure, and suspending a car over the forward hold. That was all ideas I had to make it look more like an active ship. And then looking at pictures, I made these beams on the bottom of it because that's what it would look like in a dry dock, if they put it in for maintenance. Look back with pride at what I did and how we managed to preserve it and have it at this point. I have very fond memories of all my grandparents, particularly my grandmother Steinbach.
You know, Matt, I've studied this model of USL's American Pioneer, and I find it amazing that a young adult could build such a well-crafted ship. Now, for decades to come, many young visitors will marvel that a kid around their own age could create something so beautiful.
I think that that's what we can leave here with people, is that stories like that are ones that transcend time. They connect generations from the past with our future. And so, as we wrap up this evening, we really had hoped to go further in depth on the U.S. line's history, and we realize you can't do that in a half hour or 45 minutes. So be assured, for the next several months, we'll be doing all sorts of presentations and Zoom meetings and ship talks and be focusing on USL. But we really do appreciate people tuning in tonight, and thank you for your leadership.
Oh, well, thank you very much. So that wraps up our evening tonight from our virtual gala. Now, thanks to Kathy McPherson and as our MC, and thanks to Matt Schulte, our executive director, and thanks to the guys at ATR Treehouse, who have done such a great job in the background with the tech stuff. And thank you so much for joining us as we steam together full ahead and share our maritime heritage of engine-powered vessels to generations to come. Good night.